Susan, go ahead and read the slate.
The date is January 21st, 2001. The survivor is Bertha Zimmer. Her last name at birth was Frank, first name Bertha, B-E-R-T-A. The interviewer is Susan Schreiber. We are in East Lansing, Michigan, United States of America, and the language of the interview is English. Mrs. Zimmer, can you give me your full name, please?
Right now?
Right now.
Bertha Zimmer, widowed Frank, born Frank.
And Frank is spelt?
F-R-A-N-K.
And what is your date of birth?
10th of April, 1910.
And where were you born?
In Elberfeld, Wuppertal, in Germany. Elberfeld, E-L-B-E-R-F-E-L-D, hyphen, Wuppertal, W-U-P-P-E-R-T-A-L.
And what was the largest, largest city near there?
That was a pretty big city in the Rhineland.
I see. And how old, if you were born in 1910, you are how old today?
I'm 90 years old.
And so this city that you were born in?
Yeah, still exists. But my family moved from there to Cologne when I was 2 years old.
Why did they move?
They moved for there was not much Jewish life and not much Jewish education in that city.
And
so that's why he went to Cologne. Cologne, there was a city, a big city, and there was all kind of Jewish life there.
And the family that you were born into, who did it consist of? Your parents and
my
sisters?
My parents and my oldest sister, Esther, and she was later on known as Dr. Esther Frank, for she was teaching at high school. And then I had my brother Herman, and he went to school to Latin and Greek to a gymnasium. And he went a little bit to the university, but then he went and helped my father, and he went part of the time to the manufacturing of bicycles, for my father took on wholesale for bicycles, and he wanted his son to know the details about them. And so my father and my brother had this wholesale business of bicycles and motorcycles.
So you had a brother and a sister?
And another sister. And one sister, she was Helen. She was 3.5 years older than I am. I was the youngest.
And what were your parents' names and what were they like?
His name was Karl Frank, Karl C-A-R-L, and her name was Sarah S-A-R-A-H Frank. She was a born Frank.
But were they relatives?
No, not at all.
Right. Had they been in Germany long?
Yes, my people lived in Germany a long time. They were born in Germany too.
And did you grow up in a large extended family with aunts and uncles and grandparents?
Yes. I only know one grandmother, and she used to live in Mettmann, M-E-T-T-M-A-N. I don't know one N or two.
Was that near you?
That was not far away, yes.
So?
And I had an uncle and I had an aunt in. An uncle who lived also in Mettmann with a grandmother, and then he later on lived with us. When the grandmother was old, she lived with us too. And I had a sister of my mother, Ella Frank, and when I was born, from that time on, she helped in the household with my mother.
Yeah. And she moved with you to Cologne also?
Yes.
So what was your house like in Cologne?
Well, we lived on Spichenstrasse 1171, and we lived on the first etage, and on the main floor was the business of bicycles, etc. And we also had upstairs on the, not third floor, fourth floor, we had some rooms where my son, where my brother slept and my uncle slept later on. And we had some rooms there, so we always had room enough for relatives to come and visit us. And we always had an open house. We were very friendly to all family and all other people. And in Germany, after the war, came a lot of Jewish people who went through Germany to go to America. And we always had guests there. On some people who slept there, for we were always very friendly to everybody.
This is after World War One.
That's after World War One. I remember that.
Are you from a religious family?
Very religious. We belonged to the synagogue of Rabbi Karlebach. Karlebach was the Orthodox synagogue.
Was that near your house? Do you remember?
It was well more than 10 minutes or so.
Do you remember Shabbos, what that was like?
Yes. We always celebrated Friday evening and Shabbos, and I remember that. And I light the candles always every Friday evening, as long as I can do it. Not when I am in a hospital, I can't do it, for there is too much oxygen going around. But otherwise, I always do it. And my son, Rafael, always helps me, for I'm not so good anymore with my eyes.
So, as a child growing up in Germany, what was that like? Did you live in a Jewish neighborhood in Cologne, or?
Not really. But I belonged to all Jewish groups as a child too. And I belonged to a Jewish school for Rabbi Karlebach had started a seminary for Jewish young men to become Jewish teachers. And we had a, what we called a Übungsschool. And there I went, so I always went to Hebrew schools. And then when I was 10 years old or so, he started a Jewish high school, Yavne. That's the first word, letter I don't know, J-A-W-N-E, Yavne. That was the Jewish name of the high school. And my older sister started teaching there, and I was one of the first who studied there. Went to high school till I was 16 years old, and then I, to go to the university, I had to go to make an Abitur. That's 3 years extra high school. I don't know how you call that here in America. Maybe they call it junior college. They would call it maybe junior college. For it's 3 years more of school. And then you make an examination, Abitur, and then you can go to the university.
So education was strongly encouraged in your
house? In our family. My oldest sister studied there, and my brother went to a gymnasium where he learned also a lot. And my sister Helen didn't study as well, and she only went to a pensionat, whatever that is. That is sort of a, it's not a school, it's sort of a better education for young ladies.
Like a finishing school?
Yeah, finishing school. That's right. That's okay. What it is, a finishing school. There she learns all kinds of things. But nothing much, really. Right. And that was in Baden-Baden, in Germany.
What was your mother like?
I was the youngest, so my mother was not young anymore when I was born. So she was a very fine lady, very religious, and had a very good household and took care of all kind of organizations and people. So I was learned to take care of people too.
What kind of organizations?
Well, Aguda and things like that.
So religious?
Religious, oh, yes.
Do you remember encountering any kind of anti-Semitism as you were growing up?
No. But I went to Jewish school till I was 16 years old. And then I went to the Königin Luise school, and that was non-Jewish. And people were always nice to me. I had no anti-Semitism whatsoever. No.
By the way, what language did you speak in your home?
German.
But you learned Hebrew?
I learned Hebrew in school, not at home.
So when did things start to get change in Germany for you?
Well, 33, I suddenly couldn't finish my studies at the university.
Where were you in studying at that time?
Well, I first studied in Cologne, for we had a university there, and then I went for one semester to Bonn. There was a big university there. And then I went for one semester to Munich. And I enjoyed that very much. But then I couldn't go on anymore there, for my mother was sick and wanted me to be in Cologne again. So then, after I was in Munich and made good friends there, I had to go to leave there and had to go on studying in German in Cologne.
So you moved back home?
Yes. I was at that time maybe 20 or so, 20 or 21, something like that. And then I studied in Cologne, and then came the Nazis, and I couldn't finish my studies.
Because of laws or because of?
Oh, because of laws, new laws. They didn't allow Jews to study at the university. So I couldn't finish. I was working on my doctorate, on my dissertation, and I had to finish. And that was very sad for me.
What had you wanted to study, or what did you want to?
I studied German and history, and a little bit philosophy, but mostly German and history. And then I couldn't finish anymore. I wanted to teach at the Jewish school, high school, for I had, after all, 8 semesters of studying. And they didn't want to have a second person of the same family. So he said, the principal, Mr. Klibanski, said, I can take care that you are sort of a private teacher and I give you students that you can make money. And that's the way we agreed then. So I worked at home, and I was teaching students who came from all kinds of places, of Denver, of Cologne, and I mean of suburbs and neighborhood cities too, for the Jews, students were not allowed anymore to the non-Jewish schools. So they had to go to the Jewish high school in Cologne. And so I had plenty of students whom I was teaching from morning till evening nearly. And I was very busy with that.
And you would be teaching them German?
All kind of things. I had to teach everything. I had to teach German, I had to teach history, I had to teach Hebrew, I had to teach everything. But I could do that. But it was quite strenuous. I did that from 33 on, or 34. I think I worked the whole year on my dissertation first, and then when I realized I couldn't finish, then I went to teaching. And then in the summer, my oldest sister Esther and I, we went in vacation 1 year to Baden-Baden. There was still a Jewish hotel. And then the following year, then I don't know, 36 or something, 37, I don't know exactly. Then we went to Bad Ems, E-M-S. And that was not far from us, and there was not a Jewish hotel, but there was a Jewish home for old Jewish teachers. I didn't even know about that. And they took some guests too. So I went there with my sister Esther, and I said to her before we left, "Oh, there are only old people there. I wear only some old tennis dresses. I don't take nothing nice along." And so we went there, and when we went there and went to the dining room, the first thing I saw was a very handsome young man sitting there. And I couldn't believe it, that there was somebody there like that. And then they put us right next to him at the same table, and he introduced himself and he said, "My name is Rabbi Gerhard Frank." And we said, "Oh boy, that's the same name. We have the same name, Frank, too." So we introduced ourselves and we right away got in conversation. And that's the way I first met my husband. And I fell in love with him and he fell in love with me. We were both not very ugly-looking people. We were sort of pretty people. And we talked, and he said to me, let's go a little bit walking. And we went walking and talking and talking and walking, and we fell in love very hard, on both of us. But that was already the time when the Nazis were in Germany and people liked to go away. And we couldn't get away, for we had still our business and we still had an uncle there and an aunt there and all kind, and my parents were not so young anymore. So to make it short, I don't want to tell you a whole love story. Anyway, the whole story is he asked me if I want to marry him. And I said yes, for I fell in love with him so badly. So he came with me to Cologne and talked with my parents. But then it was very hard times, and he said I shouldn't move to Ichenhausen. He would go to another city, Lübeck, where he would be rabbi. And I said, that's fine. But then the crystal night appeared, where the Nazis took over, burned the synagogues and put lots of men in concentration camp. So my seamstress was a very nice person. She was not Jewish, but she came to us and she said, "Your men have to leave the house, that they should not be inhafted by the Nazis." So my father and my brother left the house and we stayed there. And when the Nazis came, the people who lived underneath us, we were on the first etage, and the people said, "There are no Jews who you can take care of. There are no Jews here." But that wasn't true. But then the Nazis left and left us alone. So we were lucky at the time of the Kristallnacht. But then in the same evening, I got a phone call from my in-laws. I was only engaged, I was not married yet. And they told me that my fiancé was in prison already, or in concentration camp. So he was in concentration camp in Dachau. D-A-C-H-A-U. And there, and if I could do something to get him out. So I certainly, I had to go first and had to tell the Germans in Cologne at the official place that I couldn't marry now, for my fiancé was in Dachau, in concentration camp. And then I talked with one rabbi, reform rabbi in Cologne, and I asked him what I could do to get my fiancé free again, for I was very excited about it. So he called the Oberrabbinat in Amsterdam and told them that he needs a permit for Rabbi Gerhard Frank in Holland so that he could get out of the concentration camp. So I went the same night, and they promised they would do that. They would send us a permit to Holland that he could go out of the concentration camp. So the same night I went by train to Augsburg. That is the next Augsburg, AUGSBURG. That's the next city to Ichenhausen. For Ichenhausen is a smaller place. So I went by night to Augsburg and went took a cup of coffee and made myself presentable so that I looked all right, and went to the Gestapo. That is the police of the Nazis. But I had to go there to do something for my fiancé. So I went to them, and it's a creepy feeling when they close the doors behind you, for you are really, they can do with you what they want.
Mrs. Zimmer, let's talk more about this on the next tape.
Okay.
Let's just.
I have some.
I'll just start by saying this is tape number two of the interview with Mrs. Zimmer, and then I'm just going to ask you to go back.
We are rolling now. So.
Okay, can I go back to World War II? You know, in.
Okay, Mrs. Zimmer, Susan's going to introduce the beginning of the tape. So go ahead, Susan.
Just this is tape number two of the interview with Mrs. Zimmer. Mrs. Zimmer, before we go on to World War II, just do you remember things about what life was like during World War I in your family?
Yes, I do remember a little bit. I was a child then, and they always had told me when there is a bombardment from flyers, for it's a World War One, that was, Cologne was pretty close to the border, so the flyers could go over Cologne and bomb them, bomb the city. And I had the order every time, if there is a bombardment, you go in the next house and don't go over the street. But I was 4 or 5 years old, and I was in the garden there, and I had only one block to run. So I ran through, nobody was on the street, it was scary, and the bombs were falling, and I ran home, and they were so angry at me that I had run home. I shouldn't have done that, it was dangerous. So, but I did that. Then I remember from one holiday that we were at the synagogue, and suddenly there were bombs there. And we, women and children, went to the next schoolhouse, which was nonsense, we shouldn't have gone there. But we did there, and some men stayed there in the synagogue, for the Torah scroll was open, and you don't let a Torah scroll alone. So I was very proud that my father stayed in synagogue to stay with the Torah scroll. Shouldn't be alone. And then afterwards we heard that the bombs had fallen only one or two blocks away from us. So we had been in great danger and we didn't even know that. So that I remember from the World War One, when I was a child still then. So at the time of the Kristallnacht, we realized that we couldn't stay longer in Germany. We had to go away. And my oldest sister had one friend who was an English student from England. And he said he will talk with his grandmother, that she invited her to her house. And so my sister Esther tried to get out. My brother Herman tried to go over the border clandestine. That's not easy, you have to walk over the border and you have to pay somebody that he helps you. And he tried it once, it didn't work, and then he tried it once more, and he went over to Belgium. It was dangerous, but he had to do it, for we had no relatives there, really, somewhere where we could have asked to go. So my sister Esther went to England, my brother Herman went clandestine to Belgium, and my sister Helen was married and went with her husband to England. And I was at the time already in Holland. My fiancé and I, we married in Cologne before he went to Holland. And then he had to go to Holland, and I had to stay still with my parents, for I had no permit It was a permit for him, but not for me. So then when he was in Amsterdam, he tried very hard that I should get a permit too, so that I could follow him to Holland. And that's the way we went. I went to Holland. And then when I went to Amsterdam with a new permit I had, he had gone to Rotterdam to pick me up, and so we crossed each other. And I went to Amsterdam then and was in a retirement, not in a retirement, in a refugee home.
But before that,
yes,
at the end of the last tape, he was still in Dachau.
In Dachau. So after Dachau, well, I went to the Gestapo and talked with them, and they were very friendly to me. And they said, oh, we understand you want to see your fiancé. And I said, yes, I really want to. And they said, it takes a few days and you can go. And I asked, can I pick him up at Munich? And they said, no, don't do that. He will pick up, he will be allowed to go home in a few days. So we were very disappointed, my in-laws and I, but what could we do? So we went to bed on Friday evening, I remember, and suddenly the bell rang, and there was Gerhard, and we were so happy to see him, and I was so excited, I lost my voice. I couldn't talk. I was so excited, I couldn't talk anymore. But the others were so talking so much, everybody was talking, so nobody noticed that I didn't say a word. The only one who noticed it was my fiancé. And he took my hand and he held my hand till I got calmed down a little bit. And then we said we want to marry as soon as possible. And we went to Cologne and married there. And then he had to leave very soon to Holland. And then I came back a week or two later. I could go officially then to Holland too.
And you had to say goodbye to your parents?
That was terrible. My father was sick, and my mother was an old woman. And in the same week, my oldest sister Esther left on Monday or Tuesday to England. And the same week, on Thursdays or Friday, I left too. And it nearly broke my heart, for I knew I would never see them again, which was true. But I said goodbye to my father, who was still recuperating from sickness, and from my mother, who had heart problems and couldn't see well. It was terrible. But at that time, my Aunt Ella was still there, who took care of them. She was younger, and she took care of them. And my uncle was there, who was pretty good in shape too. So he was all right too. But I never saw them again. And I knew I wouldn't see them again. But I couldn't help it, I had to go. And my father said, you have to go, don't wait another day, go. You never know, it must be war pretty soon and you are stuck then. You better go. So I left.
And
what could I do? I had no chance. The only chance, I had to go to my new husband in Holland. And we were there in a refugee camp for the Dutch Jews. Had so many German Jews who came as refugees that they didn't know what to do with all of them. It was not easy for the Jews to take care of it. For they had to take care of these German Jews who came as refugees.
So this was time frame was in...
That was maybe 1937, 38. That's about the time frame.
It was just after Kristallnacht?
It was after Kristallnacht and a year and two afterwards. And I was pregnant there. And that is a very strange story I have to tell. The Dutch Jews had so many refugees from Germany that they had to do something about it. And they started a new camp, Westerbork, for them. That was pretty close to Germany, but still in Holland. So they made a big camp there. And the most ironic thing I ever saw in my life was that this refugee camp, which was started by Dutch Jews for the German Jews who were refugees, this same camp later on was taken by the Nazis and was made by the Nazis to a deportation camp for their own Dutch Jews. Do you understand what I mean?
The irony of it?
The terrible irony is that the Dutch Jews made this camp for German Jews who were refugees and who came to be helped from the Nazis. And this same camp, when the Nazis took over Holland, the Nazis took over the camp. That was wonderful for them. They had right away a camp what they needed, and they used it for a deportation camp for their own Dutch Jews, also the German Jews, but mostly the Dutch Jews. That took a while. First, there was very little food anymore in the camp. First, I should say, no, that's true. And so, I was a wife of a rabbi, and I had to take care of things like welfare. So I got organized and talked with a group in Amsterdam that they should send us some food, for we didn't have much food anymore. For the Germans, when they took over Holland, they took all the good food which was in Holland, like butter and cheese and all these kind of things, and they sent it to Germany for it. Germany was poor on food, so there wasn't much food anymore.
Right. This is at the beginning of Westerbork?
Yes.
Wait, and you were pregnant, but where did you have your baby?
My baby I got in Assen, Holland. That's a small town near Westerbork. For I was in Rotterdam, and my husband was sent to Westerbork to start this new camp in a religious way. And they used him as rabbi, but they didn't pay him for that. They didn't pay nothing. So as long as we were in Rotterdam, I remember the rabbi from Rotterdam, the upper rabbi, they get paid extra for taking care of the German refugees, but they didn't give us nothing. And they divided that time for my husband and time to work for this and for that and teaching, and I was teaching. And after a while I said, how much do you want us to do for nothing? And he got a red head, but he said nothing. So we went for nothing teaching for German children, German Jewish children, and we had to go through the haven, through the, you name it, this Hafen, haven, huh? No, I don't know. Anyway, so whenever we had to use a bus, we saved the money we got for the bus and walked. And then we went and bought some ice cream or something. Just we were so poor, you know. We got no money. So that was the time in Holland. And then I was pregnant and I stayed in Rotterdam and I said, I can't stay in Rotterdam alone. I know nobody here. And they sent me to the clinic for the poor people. And when I went there once, I realized that was a polyclinic for poor people. And there were good doctors there. But I went to the Oberrabbi David and told him, would you send your wife to that polyclinic? And he said, no, I wouldn't. So I said, why should I go there? And then he said, oh, well, we take care of you. And you get someplace else. But then, when it came to it, I didn't want to stay alone in Rotterdam. I knew nobody there. So I said, I want to go to Westerbork. And they said, you can't go to Westerbork. It's too primitive to get a baby there. You know, they started that. So they sent me to a doctor, and the doctor said, oh, you are not in labor yet, and we sent you to Westerbork, and if you get in labor, you go off the next station and go to a hospital. And I thought, how can a person be so heartless to do that to me? And I said, well, I will not do that. But then they said, it's nothing wrong, you can do that. So I was fool enough and went with them, went in the train and went till Assen. And in Assen, some Jewish people took me in. And young people, nice young people, they took me in and I stayed with them and the baby didn't come yet. You know how that is with babies, you never know. You cannot say exactly the date it should be, but it wasn't. So after all, I don't know if it was a week or two, I stayed with them and they were very, very nice to me, but we always had this language difficulty. I spoke no Dutch, not much Dutch, and they spoke not much German. But I was lucky, I got a doctor who could speak German. So the doctor could talk with me and I got in labor there And then they realized I had a hard time with labor, so, and I got nervous, and they tried to call my husband from Westerbork. They called him by car, and he stayed with me to get the baby. And for I had a midwife who spoke Dutch, and I had a nurse who spoke Dutch, and only the doctor spoke German. And also my husband spoke. So I got the baby.
You got the baby, and the date of that was?
November 22nd.
And 1938?
39. 39, huh? 39, I think so. So, and for the Bris Mila, a rabbi in Amsterdam had jokingly said, I was pregnant at the time. He said, if you get a baby boy, I will come and make the bris mila. And he said that jokingly, but he meant it seriously. And he really went from Amsterdam to Assen and came and made the bris mila for my little boy. That was a great honor that he did that. That was very nice. And the people were very nice to me and stayed nice with me. And the doctor didn't allow me to go to Westerbork. It was too primitive, so I had to stay a few weeks with these people. And they were nice all the time to me. And the doctor was very nice to me, too. But then after a few weeks, I went to Westerbork, to the new camp for German Jews. And everything was so primitive, if they were weighing my baby, they had it took a kitchen weight to weigh him. They had nothing else. But it was all right, and everything worked out all right.
And what were your living? What was the accommodations like?
I was living in a little barrack. There was a bedroom and a living room. And in the bedroom there was my husband and the baby. And I was in the living room, for that was a room that was right away open to the door then, open to the outside very soon. So like that we lived for quite a while. But then he was born in November, and then in May, the following year, the German overran Holland. The German army and they were flying over Holland, and they took over Holland, and we were supposed to be going to Rotterdam. So the Dutch commandant at the night went through our camp, and my husband too. They went over, and my husband came back and said, you better dress yourself, we have to go away from the camp. So we had to walk for an hour, and I had to take the baby on a little wagon, took him along, And we went along and went to the station where there was really a train for us, waiting for us. And my husband, he could organize everything. He was such a good guy. He could do all that. He organized the whole train, and we all were sitting there. And then suddenly, the opera band, Levison from Leeuwarden came. He had been by chance in that neighborhood, and he took over the train, and he said to the people there who took care of the train that we shouldn't go to Rotterdam, we should go to Leeuwarden, where he lived, and he could take care of the whole thing. And so we didn't go to Rotterdam, and afterwards we heard that Rotterdam was terribly bombed by the Germans. So we were very fortunate that we didn't go to Rotterdam. But our train was the only train. There was nothing in the whole neighborhood, nowhere, no train, no cars, nothing. We were the only train going to Leeuwarden. Leeuwarden is Leeuwarden. Leeuwarden. So, and when we came to Leeuwarden, we had to walk there to the city hall, and there Rabbi Levison and my husband took care that all the people were taken someplace privately so that they could live there for the time being, for we didn't know what would happen. And then we heard on the radio that the Queen of Holland was leaving to England. And that was a terrible feeling. Then we knew that we were in the hands of the Germans again. And that was a terrible feeling for us, that our whole protection, the Queen, wasn't there anymore. She had to go. She was gone with an English ship, she was called. She was picked to England.
At this time, how many of you had left Westerbork and gone to on that train? About how many?
I can't tell. Several hundred.
Let's go on to let's talk about that further in the next tape.
Okay.
This is tape number 3 of the interview with Mrs. Bertha Zimmer, and the date is January 21st, 2001. And Mrs. Zimmer, you had left by train from Westerbork, and you were in Leeuwarden?
Leeuwarden.
And you were starting to describe.
So We were in the city hall, and Rabbi Levison and Rabbi Frank tried to divide the people of Westerbork into Jewish families who lived in Lebanon. For we had to stay there for several days. And we didn't know how long, for we had to see what happened with Holland when the Germans took over. So we were the last to go, for first all the families had to be taken care of. And then we went to the house of the Rabbi Levison and stayed there. And I was so tired, I couldn't even take care of my baby. And I gave my baby to the missus from the rabbi so that he should take care of the baby. I just couldn't anymore. And then we realized that the Germans took over the country Holland. So my husband and some other men from our group from Westerbork thought, and he asked me if I mind if he would try to go to the ocean, if they could find a ship to England. And I said, no, I don't mind. If you want to go, you go. And I stay with the baby here. I didn't like it, but what could I say? I should let him go. So he left with some other people to go through the border, to the ocean, to find a ship to England. And I was sitting there alone with the baby, and I thought, my God, what shall I do? But I couldn't do anything. So the same evening late, he came back. They hadn't gone through to the coast. The Germans were there already. So he was satisfied. He had tried, but it hadn't worked. So he couldn't. I was quite happy to see him back. In a way, on the other hand, I would have liked very much he would have gone. So at night, Rabbi Levison and Rabbi Frank went away from the house overnight so that shouldn't be in trouble. So we females stayed with the children alone there. But nothing happened, everything was all right. So the next day I even dared to go on the street again, and some German wanted to talk with me and ask me something. And I said, I don't understand. I played to be Dutch. And I said, I don't understand. Which wasn't true. Sure, I understood that very well. But that was all I could do. But otherwise, the Germans didn't bother us at all. So we stayed there for a few weeks. And I even could send a card to my parents, for we were German now. We were not Dutch anymore. So I could send them a card. So that was all. So we stayed there a few weeks. And then one day they said, we can go back to Westerbork again. So we went by train again to Westerbork. And there we stayed. And it was first not so bad, for the Germans left us alone for a few weeks. But the food was getting worse and worse, and I got connection in Amsterdam with the Jodscherat, with the official rat there, that they send us some food, some bread, some sausage and stuff like that, cheese, whatever. Kosher, certainly. So we stayed there for a few weeks, and then suddenly Germans came and took over the camp. And they thought it was wonderful to have a camp right away. And they took the first time, they took half of our people and sent them away. And that was real suddenly. And I ran from one place to the other to get a little bit food to give them away, for that we didn't know nothing from nothing. So half of us were gone already, and the other half, the Germans left to take care of the kitchen, to take care of the agriculture, to take care of everything. So the camp was running quite sort of normal. But the only thing was, the Dutch were still there, the Dutch commander, but he had nothing to say, for the Germans took over. And then they took the German Jews, that was practical for them, and they organized everything should be all right. So what could we do? So we knew nothing from nothing, and suddenly German Nazis took over the camp, and that was it. And then they looked around, and then suddenly we got a group of Dutch Jews from Amsterdam, from Rotterdam, just taken care of the street, was sent to Westerbork. And they had to walk there from the last station, for there was no train stop there. So people came there, and they were so exhausted and so desperate and so nervous, they didn't know what was going on. So I looked at them and I saw, my God, what's going on? And these were the first Dutch Jews who came to Westerbork. So I picked up a table and got some bread and some coffee from the kitchen and gave that to people. So the German commandant said, "Who are you?" Oh, I said, "I'm the welfare." And he said, "That's all right, you are my Red Cross." So he allowed me to do that. So I could give that poor people who were desperate a little bit coffee and a little bit good word, you know, so to speak. And in the meantime, which I have not told, there had been a few new barracks, I don't know how you call that, wooden places built on the side of Westerbork. And there they sent, and they were all registered, these people were all registered, and then sent to the barracks there. And then they were sent a day or two later. They had to walk to the trains. It was very primitive. It was terrible. So, do you understand what that means? What I say?
Yes.
That people came from, taking care from the street, near Westerbork, and there they had the last hour to walk to Westerbork, and there they had nothing. They got a little bit, and the day or two later they were sent, they had to walk again to the station, and then they were sent to the east, they said. That's all what they said, was to the east. Whatever that meant, who knew? Nobody.
So those groups didn't actually come into Westerbork?
Oh, yes.
They came right on the outside?
No, they came into Westerbork, for Westerbork was nothing else but the commandantur, where the officials were, and then there were very few places where they could stay, so they had to stay in these long barracks. I don't know what to call these barracks, wooden frame, not houses, but longer barracks. Things, you know, for lots of people. And there they stayed for maybe a few days or a week, and then they were sent to the east, and then the next group came. So, like that, it was very hectic suddenly. And then we even got people with babies, with children, and I had to go and get a table and had to try to get everything was necessary for babies too. And I was suddenly in welfare of a big people, lots of people, 1,000 people. And we had to send 1,000 people away every time.
And was it the 1,000 people that had just come in that
yes.
would leave?
Yes. So the next were coming. So it was suddenly very, very busy, everything. And I took care as good as I could to help a little bit, which was very hard.
These were Dutch Jews who were coming
yeah.
in. Were they able to communicate what was going on in the rest of Holland at the time?
No. They were so disturbed. They knew nothing from nothing. They knew very little. They were on the street and suddenly Nazis had come and had said, you have to go with us.
And you mentioned that you had been able to write your parents.
That was once, yes.
Did you hear back from them?
Yes. I got back that I got back a little bit from them. But that was all censored. You could only write what Germans could look at.
But at that time, your parents, you knew that your parents were still alive.
Well, my father was killed. My father died. My father died and my mother was deported to Theresienstadt, to Camp Theresienstadt. This I heard. But that's all I know. I knew very little.
So there you were in Westerbork.
And I was in Westerbork with a baby.
And this is the camp that at first, when you had left, you were glad to go back to.
Yes.
But then it changed.
It changed to German Nazi hands. And they built a villa for the Nazis outside. But we were really completely rounded by Nazis with guns and everything, you know. It was not so simple. Well, there's so much I could tell you, I don't know where to start.
What was daily life like?
Well, I was busy. I had to take care of all the problems there were, and there were always problems. There were people who were sick, we had to take care that we had sort of a station in every, that we had, somebody could take care of sick people too, you know. People were living there, but there were also people who died there, and people who were sick there. It was very, very hectic. I cannot tell you how the life was. And I, one day, got very sick. And I felt miserable. And I told it to my friend, and she said, you have to see a doctor. So she sent a doctor there to me, for we had also all kind of people, doctors too. And so a doctor took me and I had high temperature and I had pneumonia. So you have to go to, we had only a primitive little hospital. So he said, you have to go there right away. I said, I can't go there. Who takes care of the baby? The baby was half a year old, or maybe six, seven, 8 months, or 9 months. Who takes care of the baby? For my husband was very busy all the time. He had to take care of the school system and everything. So he said, well, we take the baby along and somebody in the hospital has to take care of the baby. What could I do? I was sick like a dog. I couldn't do nothing. So I went with the baby to a primitive little hospital and they put me in a room alone that shouldn't be contagious. And the baby I didn't see at all. And my husband was allowed at the door once in a while. That was all. So I stayed there, I think, for 4 or 6 weeks. I was very sick. I had a not normal, unnormal pneumonia, something like that. After I was through with it, so I came back. They allowed me to have a young girl to take care of me and to take care of the baby, for I couldn't do much myself. So for a while I couldn't do nothing, and then when I could do a little bit, I had to do welfare again. So I was very busy, but I kept the young girl, and she it was Julchen, such a nice young girl, and she was very nice. She took care of us, and in our house she heard quite a lot for my husband was a rabbi, so he knew quite a lot what was going on in the camp and what people were sick and what people happened. But she never told anybody anything. She was very nice and correct with everything. And we tried to keep her, but when her parents left, I couldn't say anything. She wanted to go with her parents. She was deported. They were deported and she went with them. And I felt very sorry about it. But at that time, I was still there. And I even was allowed to talk by telephone with Amsterdam to the Jewish welfare. For they called always and asked what I need and what I don't need and what they have and what they can send me and so on. And the Germans allowed me to use the telephone. But they could listen to every word I said, for I couldn't say anything wrong. So, and then the Germans started to put a station for trains there. And they built that there. They had people came and built a station with for a train so that the trains could come right away from Westerbork wherever they wanted to go. So then we had at the time twice a week deportation to the east, they called it. And then, but they were mostly Dutch Jews. And the irony was that this camp had been started with Dutch Jews by themselves. And the Germans had only to take it over. And they built a station for trains there.
Am I understanding that mainly the people at this point who were deported were people, Dutch Jews, who had come in and just spent a couple of days and were in transit?
Yes.
And then?
Yes.
Okay.
That's like in transit. Sometimes, let's say we got a few, quite a lot of people, and so many people we didn't have to send away. Then we, the others, stayed a few more weeks. That happened too. But they only were in transit. That was all. And I took over the welfare, which was quite a lot to do, for we always gave something along in every wagon of the trains. And the trains were trains for cattle, not persons, you know? So there were nothing in there, and we had to give them some food, for there was no food supply there. So we got some food after a while from Amsterdam, from the Joodse Raad. And I know one day they called me if I could take care of a wagon full of food. And I said, sure I do. But I really didn't know where to put it. But I couldn't say no, for people were hungry. How can you say no? So I said yes. And then I went with my friend through the camp and looked where we could put it. Maybe for a night or so. And then I found one place which was half built, but half open. And I said, that we take, there we take it. And she said to me, Pepe, how can you do that? I said, that's very simple. We said, somebody there who can eat whatever he wants and sit there all night and watches that nobody steals. And that happened. And that's what we did. I never said no. It was just absolutely necessary, and I had a lot of people who were organized and then who went and gave the food out to the different people. For that was necessary, for they didn't get much to eat, and it was absolutely necessary. So I was very, very busy. And in the evening, sometimes my husband came and said, you have to stop now. you get sick yourself. You have to stop, you have to go home and have to go to bed. And he waited till I got myself together to go, for it was always so much to do. It was a coming and going and going and coming. Do you understand that?
I do.
That's a terrible, it was what you call a deportation camp. It lived in every, it was in every place where they had conquered a country. They had one in France, they had one in Belgium, they had in Holland. In Holland was Westerbork, where I was.
Were you still living in the same barracks?
Yes.
You
and my husband and my little boy.
Did you have a relationship of any kind with the commander of the camp, or
no?
Who contacted you to when there was food coming, or asked you
in
to?
In Amsterdam, they called on the phone for me.
I see.
And I went to the phone and talked with them. But then that was interesting too. One of these days, there came a tall man, and he was not Jewish, and he looked around, and I went to him and I said, "Who are you? What are you doing here?" And he said, "I'm a Quaker, and I want to help." He was not Jewish, he was a Quaker, and he was looking for me to hear what was going on. And then he was smart enough and talked with a German commandant too, and he stayed there as a helper of some kind. And he stayed there till I left. He was still there. And he helped me very much. He helped me to get in every barrack or place. Somebody, they called it like a station for helping sick people. I don't know how you can say that in English or in German or in Dutch. In Dutch it was Hike, I don't know the name anymore, Bike something, but I don't know exactly what it is.
Maybe like a small infirmary?
Yeah, like a small infirmary. That's exactly the right word, small infirmary. So we had, you know, there were maybe several hundred people in one of these barracks, so we could use such a small infirmary to help.
Let's end this tape here and
yes,
talk more about it in the next tape.
Boy, are we going on?
Four of the interview with Mrs. Bertha Zimmer, and the date is January 21st, 2001, and we were talking about Westerbork. We were going on, you had a Quaker helper, and you set up infirmaries in the small infirmaries in the large barracks.
Yeah.
And what was the role of religion? Was Was there time for religion? In
well, we had always service on Shabbos. And on weekdays mornings, too. There was a role for religion, yes. For the rabbi was always busy. He was always busy to direct the services. And if somebody died, he had to take care of that. There were lots of things he had to take care of. And he took care of people, too. He could talk with people very well, you know. They were so desperate, and they were so nervous, and they were so unhappy. And he tried to help them. And for a while, we even had in our little barrack some rabbis who were there, and they were learning together a little bit. Once that was very nice. But some of the rabbis were sent away too.
When we say the rabbi,
the rabbis, we mean several rabbis, Dutch rabbis.
But when we say the rabbi, you're talking about your husband.
Yeah. Right.
And there was a school in the...
For the children. What could they do with the children? The children first had a director from outside. But then they thought it was nonsense, and they asked my husband if he could do it. And he had to have some references. And I asked some of my friends if they could give him references. They didn't even know him at all. But they gave references to him that he was really a good director for schools. So he took care of that. But that wasn't good for him for that. He had too much to do. He was too busy.
Were there any bar mitzvahs that you remember?
I can't remember, but we had a wedding, I remember. I had a wedding, I remember, that my husband performed here. But I think it was only one wedding, I remember. Bar mitzvah, I don't know. There might be, I don't know. There were so many things. There were always something going on. You know, we were always had people coming and people going. Not the same day, but let's say on Monday people came, and maybe on Wednesday or Thursday the train rolled back.
But the original people were still there? The German Jews that...
Half of them. Half of them were sent away right away, and then the other half stayed there. They were busy, you know, with the bookkeeping, the registrations, the kitchen, everything had to be taken care of. It's technical things involved. And my husband got into trouble through the school. But, you know, it's so hard to explain to you. Can I explain, for instance, that I had maybe 100 people who helped me with taking care of welfare, of all kind of things. So then they said to me, the commandantur, you have to give 10 people away. They have to be for deportation. How do you go and find out which 10 people you let go? I was sitting in the evening late and I couldn't. It's so hard to do that, to put people away to give people away, 10 people, and they were all nice people, and they all had families, and I was always heartbroken to do that. But I had to do it. I had to give 10 people away. You have to do with 10 less. Finish. What could I do? What could you have done? It's a terrible choice. You have to send 10 people away and you don't know where it goes anyway. To the east. Whatever that means. That was all I knew. And that was one of the worst things I had to do. That I had some people give away, even if they did good work and did all right and nothing was wrong. It was just that I had to give 10 away. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's a terrible thing to do. But I had to do it. Otherwise, I was sent away myself. If I would have said no, it was very simple. Would have been no problem. At good last, we were sent away anyway. At good last, it was that the Americans came already to Belgium. And we were in Holland. And they still found a cattle train for us to send us away. So my husband was not in such good favor anymore, for it had happened in school that one child had been sick and one teacher had sent another child to give the homework to this little boy. And that was not allowed, that a child was in daytime allowed on the street. And for that, who was blamed? My husband. For he was the director of the school. And for that, when the last deportation came, my husband, I, and my little boy were sent away in the last cattle train to Theresienstadt.
So, was the camp at
the camp, there were not many people there anymore. And there was only a skeleton, how do you call it? Skeleton group.
Crew
of people there to let the camp running, so to speak. But the rabbi, it seems, wasn't necessary. So we were sent away.
What was that?
Terrible. That was terrible. I'm still dreaming of being deported at night. So I'm dreaming of it. Not as bad anymore than I used to, but I still do.
The three of you were together?
Yes. We were all three together. There was nothing to sit down, so my little boy could sit on a suitcase. We had it taken along, and we were like sitting ducks there, for we had to go through Germany, and the trains and the cattle wagons were closed. So, and there were lots of bombardment in Germany at the time, but we went right across Germany, and when we stopped was a little station in Camp Theresienstadt, in Czechoslovakia. So we went from Holland through Germany, through Czechoslovakia.
Do you have any idea how many days?
No, I don't know that. I can't say, for it was dark anyway. There were no lights there. I don't know how long, but it was quite a while. We went through Germany, and we stopped in between and things like that, but we were not allowed to go out, and we got nothing. It's so primitive, you can't imagine. Terrible. And when we came to Theresienstadt, somebody was yelling, out, 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 out. And so my little boy, they opened the doors, and my little boy got lost. We couldn't find him. He had been scared and had run out. So after a while, I saw him, and he was looking for us, and I kept on to him and said, you may not leave us, you have to stay with me. And so that was all right. But then when we were in that little station of Theresienstadt, I got out and looked around and I said, it smelled like deportation here. I don't know why I said that. It smelled like deportation. There was a little station there, and it felt it was like deportation too. So then we were separated, the men on one side and the women on the other side. And the men were sent to register. And there at the registration was one man who was from the congregation of my husband. And he said to him, we had papers from San Salvador, and we thought that might help us. We had gotten that from Switzerland, from family of Gerhard Frank. So, and we got that through, I think, the Quaker or something, the Kommandantur he gave us to us before we left. And that was a good idea. It might have helped it. But then when my husband met these men of the of this own congregation, they said to him, don't tell that you have papers. Say nothing, for otherwise you go to another camp. So my husband came to me and said, don't say anything about the papers. So I listened to him, for shouldn't I? It was the only thing I could do. So I said nothing neither, and I stayed with my little boy together. And then the females were sent to another rooms, and there we were examined by the, I don't know if there were nurses or doctors or who that was, about our lower extremities. I don't know how they called it. The female parts of the body. Is that plain enough?
It's plain enough.
Female parts of the body, and they examined each one of us thoroughly. And I was very astonished. I didn't like that. And I asked one of them, what's that all about? Oh, that's all about if you are pregnant or not. I said, why? Well, what's the problem? Oh, they said, it's no problem. If you are pregnant, you go to the little fortress. But I didn't know what the little fortress was. Oh, dear. Can somebody take it? It's maybe my son.
Go ahead.
Ich habe kein Telefon.
Sorry for the interruption. You were saying that about the little fortress?
Yeah. And the little fortress, I didn't know what it was. But if somebody went to the fortress, he was never seen again in this world. So the fortress must have had something to do with killing the persons.
So this was when you first got to Theresienstadt?
Before I even was in the camp Theresienstadt. It was right the first beginning of Theresienstadt, that we females all were examined thoroughly by somebody, and if we were pregnant, we were sent to the... Nobody was ever seen again. But the other people didn't ask what it's all about. They thought it was just nothing. But I think it was a very important thing that people who were pregnant were never seen in Theresienstadt. There were no babies there and no pregnant women. There were lots of old people there, and there were a little orphanage there where there were some children who had no parents anymore, who were alone.
Approximately when was this?
44, I would say, 44, 45. 44. It was 44.
Towards the end of the year, or?
That I don't know. Mm-hmm. You see, the time goes so strange when you are in concentration camp. You don't know the time very well. You don't know if it's, you know, it's cold or it's warm, but otherwise you don't know. You know very little. I know when I was in Theresienstadt, there was suddenly a deportation of men. And before that was, before I heard about deportation, I said to my husband, you have to go with the San Salvador people, Salvador papers, and show them to the German commandant that we are not sent away. And he said, yes, I will do that. And he went on the evening to the German commandantur. But there was, while I was talking with him, we were not alone. There were lots of people in that room. And there was one older lady who was hanging around my bed all the time and wanted to listen what I was doing there. So she must have heard what I said to my husband. And she must have told her family that. For in the evening, my husband went there and I gave him the papers and he should show it to the commandant, and he said he would do it. And the next morning when I came, he said he was so very tired, he hadn't waited for the commandant to come, and he had given to the other people the papers to show them to him. And I was deadly scared. I thought, my God, how could you do that? You can't trust anybody in camp. They all are thinking only for themselves and not for others. So, the following day, as I thought, they said to him, the Germans refused the San Salvador papers. So, and then when it came, a man transport, the first man transport, he went without him. So it was all right. I was so scared, I went every morning. I went to the building where he was, for we were separated, and I ran there and see if he was still there. And thanks God, every morning he was still there. But one morning he said to me, I go to the, there will be deportation of some men, and I will be there too. And I said, you can't go. And he said, I have to go. The commandant had not allowed me. So I went to my friends, to my Dutch friends, and begged them if they could do something for him. And my friend Notaris Spier said, I cannot help you in this case. I have another case which I have to take care of, and I cannot take care of this case. So my husband had to leave. And my husband said to me, and I never forgot that, he was much smarter than I ever was. And he said to me, whatever you have to do to save your life or the boy's little boy's life, I will never, never complain about it when I see you. You can do whatever you have to do. That was the kind of husband I had. He was just a wonderful person. Thanks God, I never had to do anything special. Thanks God. But he left, but he said goodbye to my little boy, and I didn't go there. He left them alone. Well, I was afraid my heart would break into pieces. And I was very, very disturbed afterwards. And the only thing which kept me going was I couldn't leave my little boy alone. He had nobody there. What should he do? So one day when I was so very desperate, I walked through the place and I met an older woman. And she said, what's the matter with you? I said, it's nothing the matter. I'm sort of a little bit disturbed. I don't know what to do anymore. And I told her the whole story. And she said, you go to the rabbis and talk with the rabbis. They might find a way what you can do. And she gave me good advice. And I don't know who that was. It was like an angel who came to me and gave me some advice. So I went to the rabbis, and there a strange thing happened. I went, they said to me, you want to talk to Rabbi Beck? And I said, yes. But I didn't know who that was. And that was a very famous rabbi, Beck from Berlin, who wrote books and everything, was very well known. And he was in Theresienstadt, and the Germans didn't know that. And the other rabbis kept him in secret, and nobody knew about him. It was a strange, very strange thing. And he survived, I heard afterwards. And he talked with me, and he was such a nice person. And he got me a little bit out of my desperation. And he told me what to do and where to go. And it was wonderful. And I thanked him very much. And from then time on, I went also for welfare, but for welfare for Dutch teenagers. Dutch teenagers were not killed, but they had to do work. And I was one of the people who took take care of them and gave them food, brought the food from the kitchen and had to divide it to them, and food was always scarce. So I was careful and gave everybody their portion, and I waited till at last if there was something left over for me or not. So after a short while, they realized that I did that, and they said, we don't allow that. You go first and you take your part too. You have to live too. They were very nice boys, but I had to speak Dutch with them. Not, they didn't want a word of German anymore. So that was all right. But then one day I had to take care of one boy who was young man, you know, so to speak, who was sick. And he had some kind of yellow sickness. What is that called? Hepatitis. And they told me hepatitis is not contagious. And you have to take care of him. So I took care of him. And what did I get? Hepatitis. And I was very, very sick. And there was nobody who could take care of me. So I lay on my bed, couldn't eat. And the only thing I could eat was sugar. But I had very little sugar, so I changed my food against sugar so that I could get something. So I was very, very sick. And I couldn't take care of my little boy. And I was afraid he would get sick too. So I had to put him into the so-called Waisenhaus, where they were, I don't mean Waisenhaus, orphanage. So he stayed there, but he was very unhappy there. For he was used to be with me all the time. So when I was feeling better, he tried and visited. He said, brought him to me and he could visit me. And it was very hard for him and very hard for me.
I think that let's talk more about it on the next tape. And I'd like to hear about the living conditions at Theresienstadt as well on the next tape.
Okay.
This is tape number 5 the interview with Mrs. Bertha Zimmer. It's January 21st, 2001. You were in Theresienstadt, and you were just about recovering from hepatitis, and your son...
My son was in the little orphanage, and I was feeling a little bit better after a while. I didn't see a mirror for After a while, I realized that I was yellow through and through. Even my eyes were yellow. Everything was yellow. But then I was feeling already better. And when I was better, I was afraid that you never know what happens to the orphanage. They send the children away one of these days. And then I have trouble to get my little boy, Raphael, out of it. So Raphael was maybe 3 years old or something like that. 3 or 4, I don't know exactly. And he was named after two uncles. We both had, my husband had a famous uncle who was a cantor in Leipzig, L-E-I-Z, like zebra, I-Z. And he was also a person who had invented the modern Jewish writing. He was quite a well-known person. So, and I had an uncle, Raphael, too. So we both had no problem in calling him Raphael, for we both had an uncle. So now, after I felt better, which took me a while, and I got so thin, you can't believe it, I tried to get him back. But the orphanage doesn't give children back to their mother. So I went to the Judenälteste. That's the oldest of the Jews. It is not an older man, but the old sort of, I don't know how you call it. He is the one who had something to do to make order and things like that. And I went to him, and that was a rabbi, Rabbi Mermelstein. And he said, why do you want the boy back? I said, are you lonely? And I said, yes, I'm very lonely. I want to have him back. And he said, well, if you are so lonely, you can visit me. I said, no, thank you. No, I didn't say that. I said, well, I don't know. So anyway, he was nice, and he allowed me the next day that Raphael could come back to me. And we were both very happy that we were together again. For we always studied what we could eat at supper, and we always had not much to eat. So how are the circumstances in Theresienstadt, for instance? You get at lunchtime some kind of a meal, and in the evening you got a water soup. That means it was not worthwhile to go there and pick it up, for it was just water. So we made up our minds that we should eat whatever we had. So we got once a week a loaf of bread, and once a week also a little bag of sugar. And I don't know what else we got, can't remember. And this, people were hungry, so some people ate the bread right away, and so the other week they were just hungry. And some other people, like I, was different, and we always ate together what we had, so that we had the whole week something to eat. And I took, and that was one good thing in Theresienstadt. They gave you once a week a loaf of bread and once a week a little sugar. And in the afternoon you got some thick soup or something like that. Not a wonderful meal, but just a big thing of something that I shared with the boys I took care of. They are not boys, they were young men, and they are really hungry, but I couldn't give them all what I gave. I got in the kitchen. But I had on the outside, you had to wait on the outside of the kitchen, and that is in winter very cold in Theresienstadt, for it's in Czechoslovakia, and that's not a so cool country. So we had to wait outside for the main meal, and they gave us there. If you didn't go, you got nothing. That's very simple. So when you were sick and couldn't go, you were just, that's too bad for you. So you like to know what we ate there, what we lived there. We could go in the morning and got some kind of coffee. That was all. For you got your bread for once a week. And if you had something, that was good. And if you had nothing, it was too bad for you. And then for lunch, you got some kind of thick soup or thick something. Tasted like nothing. Mm-hmm. And it was nothing special, but it was some kind of food. And then in the evening, we got water soup. And I decided after a week that I wouldn't go for that, for it's not worthwhile. I can drink water as well.
So how long were you at Theresienstadt?
3/4 of a year. And I heard in Theresienstadt that my mother had died there. And my mother must have lived there half a year or so. And I thought to myself, if my mother, who was an old person, lived there for half a year, I must be survived for a year there. But it's not easy to survive there. For you live in a bed which is not a real bed, and there are insects there, bunsen and bed animals. Oh, terrible. So it was, and you were not in one bedroom, you were in a bedroom with maybe 12 people or so. There was just nothing simple, nothing nice about it. And in daytime, well, I was busy. I had to take care of the young men, the teenagers there, for the whole day. And then in the evening, we had to figure out what we could eat. And Rafael himself, he went himself and got his food. And that was something very nice in Theresienstadt. They gave to the little children a little bit better food. So they got once in a while a roll extra or something. So, and I must say, when I came to Theresienstadt, I forgot to tell that. When I came to Theresienstadt, first there was a young woman who looked what I had and what I was wearing and what I had in my little bag. And in my little bag I had a little bottle of oil and a tablet of chocolate, which I had saved for a needy case. So I had took that along. And I started talking with her, and I asked her if she knows Mitzi Kish. And she said, oh yes, I know Mitzi Kish. She is married to who knows whom in Prague. The very famous family. And I knew them from Cologne, for she was a good friend of us. So she looked at me and she said, if you are a friend of Mitzi, I let you go, you said oil and chocolate, I don't see it. Close your map and go. And I was very lucky that I could keep that. For with that I could use, make it easier for Rafael to get used to it, to have so little to eat. So if we got a potato or something, I could bake it with a little bit of oil. For a while, not for long, but for a while I could help myself. And we too always took care that in the evening Rafael had something to eat. You know what I mean? For the water soup I didn't pick up anymore, for it was worthless. And that's what people had very little to eat. And the only way when we got a good meal was when the Red Cross or something came and looked at, you know, strangers came and looked at the camp for Theresienstadt was to be called the best camp they had. And on that day we always got some better food. But that happened once, maybe in half a year or so. So in reality, we always, well, lots of people had work to do. It's not that we were sitting there. Lots of people were what they called the glimmers. It was for war things, for bombs or something to make. And I didn't do that, for I worked for the boys, but otherwise, people worked the whole day there too. So don't think people were doing nothing. Only old people did nothing, but old people didn't get much to eat neither. And the toilets were so dirty, you can't imagine. Lots of people had diarrhea there from the food, you know. So I did let Rafael go to the bus. To the bathrooms, for I was afraid he would get sick there. And I myself are very careful to go there myself. And I let him go on a little pot, so he was really trained to do all right.
So you were there for about 9 months, and then what happened?
Well, I was sick once more there, when I was there. I didn't tell you a lot of things. The most important thing I didn't tell you. When my husband was sent away, he said to me, don't go away. When they said you can go after me, don't believe that, it's not true. For he was much smarter than I ever was. So, really after he left, maybe 3-4 weeks afterwards, we got a letter, you can go back where your husband is next week. So I remembered what my husband had said, I shouldn't do that. So I said to all my friends and acquaintances, we don't go. So we said we don't go. So a week later we got a letter, we have to go. And this letter also went to Rafael as a child of 3 or 4 years old. He should go to work there, and we should go to work there. So how could Rafael go to work? Well, anyway, he suddenly got sick, had high temperature and was very sick, and I didn't know what to do. But we had to go there. So I go with my friend And we took him on the hand, both hands, for he couldn't walk. He was so tired. He was not feeling good. So I sent to my friends, my Dutch friends, Notaris Speer, and said, I need your help. Rafael is sick and I can't go to a deportation now. So we had to go to the deportation. We went to the train. We went to the little station and we were sitting there. Nothing happened. Then one day this guy who had tricked my husband came to me and said, how are you doing? I said, fine. But I thought to hell with you. And then came another one of my friends, Dutch friends, and said quietly to me, they put you out of the deportation. You can go home. But the problem is the little boy, Rafe. Rebe, how can we get him out? So he said, I have an idea. He said, you go close to the wall, and then we saw him over the wall and picking up with our hands, and there he is out, and then you go. And I said, well, it's a good idea. It's the only idea we can do. So we went to the wall. They took him over, threw him over the wall, and they picked him up there. And after he was out already, they said, now you have to go. Look, all right, put your ticket with the number out of in your pocket, and you go out as if you were working on the deportation. Go. And so I went with my heart clopping as crazy out of the Nazis into the camp again. And when I was there, my stuff was gone already. Everything had taken care of that. But Rafael and I, we were out there and we stayed there. But every time, Notaris Speer had to get me out of the deportation. For out of the deportation list, my name was always there again, in Rafael. So he could do it a few times, and then at good last he said, I cannot do that anymore. Do you have any papers? I said, well, I have only the German translation of San Salvador that I have. I gave the original to my husband. So he took it, and he came back and he said, you are free. You don't have to go anymore. It's all right. But then I got very excited. For the Germans never do that. They don't say one no to you. They would not say for the same papers yes. So I realized that this Jewish man had tricked my husband and had not shown the papers to him. For the commandant said not yes and then no, or no and then yes. They don't do that. Mm-hmm. So I got so excited about it that I got sick. And I got, I don't know how you call that, half of my head, it's a nervous sickness, half of my head was broken up. I got very sick. I don't know how you call that. Well, you usually have that in at the stomach when you are very sick, when you have got that. That's Gürtelrose in German. But I don't know the word in English. No, it doesn't come to me. It doesn't matter. It breaks up completely here. half of the... But and then there were not many doctors anymore, for they had sent away a lot of doctors with the men deportation. So it took me quite a while to get over that. But this time I kept my boy along, for I didn't want to have trouble again, that he wouldn't be there. And after that, I was still working with the, for the boys, young men, and Rafael had a playgirl there, and he came every morning. He could wash himself and dress himself, but he couldn't put his shoes on. So he had to ask somebody to help him with his shoes. And then he came to me, and he was the whole day with me. So that we lived for the last few months, that he stayed with me the whole day. We took care of the beds and of the boys, of the food, everything. There was one woman and me who did that for the boys. There were maybe 30 boys we took care of. Not boys, young men. And then something strange happened. The Germans took all the acts. Now, first of all, they asked us to throw away the urns of the people who had died there. And I thought, my mother died there, I know that, and I will not do that. So they threw the urns, the ashes, in the water of the river. And I didn't do it, I said, I'm sick. What's the day, you know? I didn't do it. So, and they gave something special, I think some sardines or something extra, but I didn't take it, for I didn't get it, for I hadn't been there. But I was very proud of myself that I hadn't done it. I didn't want to throw the ashes of my mother in the water. I didn't do it, thanks God. And then something strange happened. Suddenly the Germans in the middle of one place, they put some papers and papers and papers and burned them. And I thought, that's strange. Why are they burning all the papers, all the acts and all the papers? There were piles of papers there. And they burned them all. And so I thought something must happen. And you know what happened? The Germans left the camp. Quietly. And we were sit there alone, no food, nothing. And then a Red Cross official from Switzerland came and saw what's going on. How he knew, I don't know, but he came. And he went with his car to the no man's land and went to the Russian army and called the Russian army to help us, to liberate us. And so in the evening, we thought that the Germans wanted to take care of the camp and surprise the Russians when they would come. So I put Rafael to bed and I put him dressed completely, and I was dressed completely, and we were in a house where it was close to the border. And I said to Rafael, you know, when it's dark, I take you and we run out of the border, out of this camp. I don't want to be killed by the Germans. But the Germans wanted to kill us, and they were already starting to, how do you say that, to pull their guns against us in the camp. And I thought, I don't do that, I don't wait till they kill me, I go and run away with the boy. And then it was dark. No, it's not true. It was daytime, and they were, and the Germans were shooting at the camp. And I had to go to work, and I went to work, and then I thought, I cannot leave that little boy alone when they are shooting there. And he's close to the border too, or he can't do that. So I ran over, and I had arthritis and could hardly walk. But I ran over anyway, and they were shooting, and I always ran across when they were not shooting. So I just came to back to Rafael, and he was sitting there crying. He was alone, and he was scared from this shooting. So at night, the shooting stopped. And the Russian army came and took us over. And the first thing they took was the quarantine, for we had from the death camps typhus into the camp. And there were lots of sick people and lots of people who died. And the Russian helped us, and they came with a whole train of lazarette from, with doctors, with nurses, with everything. They took care of us, and they were really wonderful to us. And they gave us food, all kind of rich food, which we couldn't eat. So I was careful. I knew we were not used to eat rich food, all kind of canned stuff like that. And some people got sick from that, for they couldn't eat that. They were not used to it. But that's the way we stayed for, maybe after the war, for 4 weeks. But we were in quarantine, we had to have the typhus along.
And so you still stayed in
I had to stay in Theresienstadt, yes. For maybe 4 weeks or 5 weeks. And then the Dutch people were picked up. That were the Dutch people who had been officials, who had been not sent away to the east. And these were my friends. And they took me along, and the French Red Cross came with cars and took us along. And they took the Dutch group along, and they took me and my little boy along too. For we were friends. Had been friends and had been good with them. So,
well, let's talk more about that. Excuse me. Let's talk more about that on the next tape.
Okay.
This is tape number 6 of the interview with Mrs. Bertha Zimmer. It's January 21st, 2001. And, well, you have left Theresienstadt, you and Raphael, who is, if this is 1945, he must be about 6 years old. And now it's many years later. What happened to you right after the war?
Right after the war, I went with the French Red Cross, and then we were brought to Pilsen, and in Pilsen, American troop flyers put us to Holland. And there in Holland I had trouble, I was not Dutch, and they left me first in Eindhoven for a few days, and then in Amsterdam my friends took care that I came back to, that I could go back with Raphael to Amsterdam. And in Amsterdam nobody told me what happened to my husband. And I thought that something must be utterly wrong, for everybody didn't tell me. Everybody said he doesn't know. And that wasn't true. So I met on the street a former student of my husband. And I pressured him so much till he told me what happened. And I heard that he was gassed right away in Auschwitz, Camp Auschwitz, and he was 32 years old. After I heard that, I had a mental breakdown. And they put me in a non-Jewish house where people were very nice, and they let me sit there quietly in a darkened room till I was feeling better. So the only one who could see me was Raphael. And he had a very good time. He went with them to the supermarket. He had never seen such a thing in his life. And he had a real good time, and he could say hello to me. And I don't know how long I was sitting there, if it was a week or two, but it took me a while to recuperate. And then I went to a hotel which was for refugees. And then I sent a letter to my brother. I knew he was in Brussels, but that was all I knew. So I sent him a letter to the community Jewish of Brussels, to Herman Frank. And this letter arrived. It came to him. And he got the letter, and he wrote me a letter back that he would send somebody, I should go with him to Brussels, to him, to Herman. And I should wait a few days and I would do that. For it was all very difficult for the Germans. When they left, they had destroyed a lot of bridges, a lot of things in Holland before he left. So it was hard to go over to Belgium at the time. You want to know more?
Well, then, did you get to Belgium?
I went clandestine to Belgium with a Canadian truck. Nobody wanted to take me along over the border with a little boy. So the Canadian truck said, oh, come on, I take you. And they put an old sack over us, and I put the boy very quietly on my, close to me, And when he came to the border, the Canadian was really tough. They said, come on, sit down, come here and look around. We have nothing wrong. And they came up and they came around the old truck. And they said, what are that? Oh, they are old sacks. That was it. And they went out and we went back to Belgium. That was, and that's the way we came to Belgium. We had no papers, we had nothing. No papers, no money, nothing. And I was so slim, I didn't even need a bra anymore. Nothing.
And so you were reunited with your brother?
With my brother, and he was the director of a group of concentration boys, young men who had survived. And he was director of them, and they were unruly people, and I could talk with them very well, for I was one of them too, for I was also in concentration camp. And they were very nice to my little boy. They never puffed him or anything. They were real nice, and they played with him, for he was one of them.
And how had Herman survived?
He had been in Belgium, and he had been part of the time going as a non-Jew. And like that, he survived.
And was he in touch with your sisters?
Well, yes and no. We had only Red Cross letters together. But my sisters also got from the lists of Theresienstadt that I survived with a child.
So when did you come to the United States?
Oh,
how did that happen?
I lived in Belgium, and after I recuperated and filled up again and was not so thin, I got a job as assistant director of a hachshara in Belgium. My brother was director of the hachshara and I was assistant director there. And it was, you know what a hachshara is?
I don't.
A hachshara is a group of people who learn how to do agriculture in Israel. That's from Jewish groups.
Mm-hmm.
It's just Zionist groups, sort of, where you learn young people how to do agriculture for Israel. And we lived there, and we were, well, there's a lot to tell, but I will not tell you, for it's nothing to do anymore. I think I better don't go on, for I then took a job as directrice of a Jewish orphanage. For in Belgium, the children were not all killed and not all sent away like in Holland. But in Belgium, the army had to say, and the army had were not so very anti-Semitic. And they let old people live, and they let children live. So that we have orphanages in Belgium, but not orphanages in Holland. You understand
that? I do.
That's easy to understand. So they were looking for a person. They wanted an orphanage for small children. And I could do all the things they wanted. Like I could speak Dutch, and not too good though, but, and I spoke French, and I spoke some Hebrew, so I could help myself. So they was, I was just the person they wanted. So they took me as directrice for a small orphanage, which I had to start from scratch, which was not so easy. There wasn't too much money neither at the time after the war, you know. And everything was rationed too. Bread was rationed, butter was rationed, everything was rationed. But for small children, you don't need so much. So for me, it was, for my orphanage, was always enough. But they wanted I should give some rationing to others, and I said, no, I can't do that. I don't do that. I have enough for myself, but not in, not so much that I can give some away. But, you know, I took good care of the children.
For how long was that?
I don't know. A year or two.
And then?
And then they wanted me to a bigger orphanage in Brussels, in Ukel, Brussels, a suburb of Brussels. And they begged me to do that, for there was a director of the orphanage who also had started a Jewish elementary school in Brussels. And you cannot do two things, that's too much. So he did both things, and my organization didn't want him to go on doing that, for he didn't do a good job. For, you know, he was more interested in the elementary school he just started, and he didn't want to have to do much with the orphanage, but the children need support. So they sent him a letter. He wants to resign, and he thought they have nobody who can do that, take it over. So they went to me and they begged me I should do it. I should take. And they would take the children I had, half of them I should take along, the little ones, and the little bit older one I should go, they should go to Antwerp. Who is there?
Your son just came in, and we'll meet him in a few minutes. But
so then I took over the home in Ukel, Brussels. And there were in the 40 children, more than 40, and I took maybe 10, 15 more, so I had 60 children there. That was a big orphanage. And we had very little money always.
Somehow you got from there to the United States at some point.
Yes, I did. Somebody corresponded with me, and he was a friend of my first husband. And he wrote me in a letter if I was interested to marry again. And I really wasn't very interested at the time. I was not ready yet. But then I thought I'd be careful, and I wrote him, I don't know. And then he made up his mind, and he came to Brussels and picked me up and married me. And that's the way I came to America, by marriage.
Well, now it's many years later.
Yes, I should say that. And my second husband passed away, how many years? 2 or 3 years ago, right? And so I wanted to go. So my son didn't want to go all the time to Denver, and I lived there alone. My sisters had passed away, and my brother had passed away, everything. So he didn't want to go all the time, and he said I should come to Lansing. And here I am, still alive, and old as I am.
And I want to tell you that I really appreciate you doing this interview today. It has really been a privilege for me. Why did you do the interview today?
Well, there are several reasons. First of all, I want the memory of my husband, Rabbi Gerhard Frank. He should be remembered as a very efficient and very fine person. And then I want it also for my son and for my grandchildren, that they know that their grandmother went through all kind of periods of difficult times. And that I tried always to help people. And I shouldn't say nothing bad, for after all, Rafael and I were like a miracle out of deportation and survived. So I got all the thank you I should get, I got at the time when I needed it. That's all.
Thank you very much for sharing your history with us today.
It's a crazy story.
Mrs. Zimmer, would you introduce?
Yeah. This is my son, Rafael, whom I love very much and whom I took along to all my travels through the world so far.
And I am very fortunate to be here, and my mother deserves a great deal of credit for her courage and her resourcefulness in keeping a little boy alive. One of the points I think she may have made today, she's made it with me, is that obviously she kept me alive, but in one sense, I kept her alive too. I kept
That's
her going.
Right.
I kept her motivated.
That's right.
So it all worked out for the best.
Thank you very, very much.
You're welcome.
Am I finished?
This is a picture of Bertha's maternal grandmother and grandfather. And his name was Solomon Frank. Her name was Sophie Frank. She was born Hertz. This picture was taken in Germany, and we don't know the date of the picture. We assume it was late 1800s.
Go ahead.
This is a wedding picture of my mother's first marriage. So that is Bertha Zimmer, and next to her is her husband, Gerhard Frank.
You can see that Gerhard Frank has no hair on his head, for he was in Dachau, in the camp Dachau before that. And they had taken, shorn his hair. That's why he had that off.
That is a wedding picture. And my mother's, Bertha's parents are on the left side. That would be Karl Frank and Sarah Frank. And Gerhard's parents on the right side, and that would be Johanna Frank, and Johanna Einstein, and next to her is her husband, Solomon Frank, who was a teacher. It was taken in Germany. Was the wedding in Cologne?
In Cologne.
The wedding was in Cologne, so it's in Cologne, Germany. The year of the picture would be 1939, I would guess.
Yeah.
1939. left to right, that is my uncle, Houston Frank, Gerhard's brother, and on the right is Gerhard Frank, and looks like they are studying the Talmud. Houston did not survive, nor did Gerhard. This was photographed, I would guess, 1938 or something like that. And it was in Germany, probably Ischenhausen, I would think, where Gerhard lived.
I think so. Yeah. I think it's the best picture of Gerhard.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way he looked when he had no beard.
This is a picture of my work orders when I was in Theresienstadt. I was probably 4 years old. And it asks me to report to the train station ready for duty and to be prepared and to be on time. And I think the dates on there are February 10th, 1944.
Could be. Could very, very be.
These are the numbers that we wore, my mother and I, when we were supposed to be deported from Theresienstadt to Auschwitz. My name is on one of them, and my mother's name is on the other one. And my mother took her tags off as she walked by the Gestapo so that she wouldn't be stopped. And I was thrown over a wall and caught by some Dutch people on the other side. And that's why I'm here today. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here.
It's right.
This is a Jewish star worn by one of my parents. And it says Yud, meaning Jew. And it's in sort of a phony Hebrew writing. I mean, it isn't, they're not Hebrew letters.
It's just not Hebrew letters.
They're just made to look that way, but it's basically Dutch or whatever. It's a Jewish star. This is Carl Frank, my mother's father. It is in, I'm pretty sure it's in Cologne, Germany, probably in front of their building where they lived. And I don't know the exact date. It would have to be before 1939 sometime.
I think it's for his business.
In front of his business?
I think so. Is it a big door?
Yes, big, heavy wooden door.
Yeah, that's a business.
Which was downstairs from where you lived?
Not anymore, no.
Okay.
He lived separately now from there.
Okay. This is the wedding picture of the second marriage of my mother to Maui Zimmer. And you can see Maui and Bertha and her sister Leni right next to the right of my mother, and then her sister Esther to the right of that. And these are the orphans who were at the wedding. This was in Uccle in Belgium. And the year was around 1945, I believe.
Could be.
Okay. So the wedding picture of my mother and her second husband. This is Bertha Zimmer and Maui Zimmer. This took place in Belgium. And the marriage was later than 1945. It was.
Yeah, it must be later, a little bit.
It was, what year do you think it was, Ma?
I don't know, for I was a few years directrice of the orphans.
So about 46, 47, 48, somewhere
maybe.
There, is when this marriage occurred. This is my family, and starting at the top left is my son, Michael, and his, to his right, going clockwise, is Shirley. Shirley Tai, now Shirley Frank, my wife. Then there's myself, Raphael Frank. Then my daughter Megan, and my mother in the middle, and my daughter Rachel on the far left. The picture was taken here, where we're interviewing at Independence Village in East Lansing, Michigan. And the picture is fairly recent. It was taken maybe in 1999. Of course, goes without saying, I'm very proud of all of the people in that picture. And that's it.